Good evening and welcome to The Journey Home. I'm Marcus Grodi, your host for this program. Tonight's episode is a special edition of The Journey Home program. I really don't know whether Mother Angelica, back 17 years ago, when she invited me to host this program, thought that we would actually complete 17 seasons, but this is the 17th anniversary of The Journey Home program, and so we begin tonight our 18th season of The Journey Home. And truly, the reason this program is able to keep going month after month, week after week, year after year, is because of the work of the Holy Spirit opening the hearts and minds of men and women all around the world to the beauty of the Catholic Church. And often it's those who were brought up Catholic and left for whatever reason, and then at some point in their life, again, by the mercy of God, their hearts and minds are open to come home. For others, they never considered the Catholic Church, like myself. But then again, with a desire to follow Christ faithfully, hearts and minds get open to the fullness of the faith. And sometimes, jumping over great hurdles, they find their way home. And so, again, thank you for joining us on The Journey Home in the beginning of this 18th season. And it's exciting to invite to tonight's episode of The Journey Home, Cris Fouse, a former Episcopalian with quite a story because she spent some time in Africa that I'm excited to hear about. Cris, welcome to The Journey Home.
Thank you, Marcus.
It's good to have you here. It is. And as I told you before the program, I don't know that if we ever thought the program would keep going, but the Holy Spirit keeps bringing men and women like yourself home to the church.
And people love it.
Well, it's a great privilege to do it. So what I'd like to do is get out of the way as soon as I can, and Cris, invite you to start at the beginning and let us know about your journey.
Thank you. Well, I was a World War II child. God was very patient with me. It took 69 years for him to bring me home to the church.
Wow.
I was born, actually, the very month that Hitler invaded Poland, September 1939. And So immediately a lot of our men enlisted, including my father. And so I spent the first few years of my life moving from army base to army base in the Southeast. And then
just you and your mother, or
yes,
you have siblings?
And then when I was four, my sister was born.
Ah, okay.
But that was a little bit later. We ended up when my father, my sister was born, and within a few months, my father went to fight the Nazis, and so we moved to Gainesville, Florida, to live with my grandmother, and another aunt with her children moved in with my grandmother, and the other siblings, there were seven of them, all lived in Gainesville, and so we had a family town there. But it was, for me, I was the oldest of the children, and it was a very lonely time for me because as the oldest, I was kind of left to fend for myself, and I was four and a half at the time, and the women were concentrating on the babies and toddlers and worrying about their men. Yeah. And, you know, feeding the big family.
It was.
And it was a scary time, too, for me because there were German subs off the coast of Florida. We had blackout curtains, and we had to do blackouts every night.
You know, I would sometimes think, you know, I was born later, after the war. Both my parents were involved with the war. And we always look back with hindsight. We knew we won. So we look back at the war from different perspectives. But during that time, you didn't know.
And we didn't, of course, there was no instant communication, and we didn't know whether someone was dead or alive for months. We would get letters, you know, this thick, packets of letters, and knowing that someone might have written them and still be dead by now.
Yeah.
When the doorbell rang, everybody's thought was, oh no, they've come to tell us somebody's been killed. It was that kind of, you know, tension. But during that time, actually my grandfather died in the house during that time. An uncle came home wounded. They had to care for him with his bloody smelly bandages and changing. And
it was, as the oldest, you would have had to have your hands in it.
Yeah. And, but my grandmother used to take me in her lap, and she would say with me the Our Father in the 23rd Psalm. And I don't remember how frequently, but it was enough that I remember it.
And so as a family, you weren't going to?
We did.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
But because of my grandmother, I began to learn that God is good and that he's with me, even though he might be remote and far away like my father, but he was there somewhere. and that he loves me. And I learned those things. They were just deep within me from that time. My grandmother gave me a Bible when I was 6 years old, and it was the old King James, old English. And I wanted to read it so badly, and I would take it under the covers with the flashlight and try to read it. Well, I didn't get very far into Genesis before I gave up.
It's kind of hard for Genesis 1, right?
And at age 6, it was a little difficult. But anyway, it was a scary time, but it was, God was there, you know, with me. I knew that. Daddy came home when I was 7, and we moved to Miami where he had grown up. And from those years, I remember vividly that he would wake us up in what seemed like the middle of the night. It was still dark, and drive us over to the beach to watch the sunrise over the ocean. And he would talk about God's creation and the beauty of creation, and that was very deep within me during those years. We did go to church pretty regularly. We said grace at meals, and so I learned that God provides. So I was learning a lot in those early years without recognizing it, you know, really.
Was there any denominational slant to where you were going?
We were Methodists.
Methodists, okay, mm-hmm. All right.
I actually had an uncle who was a Methodist minister. And okay. Baptized me, confirmed me, and married me.
All right.
During those years, I actually never knew a Catholic that I remember. I knew they existed, but I thought they were some exotic species that, you know, would have nothing to do with me. Throughout our, you know, my early adulthood, I really kept going to church all through college. I married my husband, and we always went to church. And during the first few years, we moved around the country and joined various Protestant churches, depending upon the one that appealed to us in the place we were.
Yeah, that's the norm nowadays, yeah. Right?
We spent 10 years in Minnesota, and it was a wonderful 10 years. We kind of grew up there because our children were babies to elementary during those years. And we joined a little congregational church. And this was the 60s. And I think this kind of false spirit of Vatican II was affecting everybody. Hmm. And the Holy Spirit was leading us in new directions. And yeah. We were making all these wonderful discoveries. Well, yeah. I had no idea the spiritual danger we were in. Hmm. I mean, we were into real heresy and New Age stuff.
At the time, you were Congregationalist?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And I had no idea.
Well, I was a Congregationalist first, after ordination. Then I became Presbyterian. And the Congregationalists during those periods were, the theological width was as wide as it could get, as liberal as you could possibly imagine, as you said, with New Age elements,
mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
whole new ideas about God and different things. We're not all Congregationalists, of course. We some very conservative were, which is where I was.
There were, but we happened to be connected to this one.
Yeah, wow. Yeah. Wow.
So, suddenly, God wrenched us out of there and moved us to Texas. And it was very painful because we, you know, we had such a wonderful group of friends and we loved our church at the time.
So you didn't really reject what was going on in the church. You were kind of going along
and
liking it.
Yes, I didn't have any idea. I really had no good catechesis in Christianity up to that point. And I was just curious and letting my mind lead wherever it went.
Yeah.
No. Okay. But we got to Texas and we started looking for a church. And for 2 years, we tried all these Protestant churches and nothing satisfied. And I thought, okay, God doesn't live in Texas. I just can't find him. Well, that false God wasn't there. You know, he wasn't there for me, thank God. So after about 3 years, a neighbor invited me to come to the Episcopal Church and visit with her. And within 10 minutes, it was, so this is what I'd been looking for, and I didn't know. There was a richness and a fullness and a depth that I didn't know existed.
Yeah.
And so my husband...
Liturgy, which you wouldn't have had in the Congregational Church.
Although it was similar to Methodism in which I'd grown up.
Of course.
But it was deeper and richer. So my husband joined me very quickly, and the family joined the Episcopal Church in 1979. And we had very faithful clergy there. Anglo-Catholic, High Church Anglo-Catholic. Okay. The teachings were totally Catholic. The liturgy, you know, everything was Catholic. Yeah. And we thought we were Catholic. You know, we were taught that we were. We believed in the branch theory. Do you know about that?
Maybe. I do, but maybe for the audience that might not be familiar with the branch theory, because that is important for the Anglo-Catholic.
That the Catholic Church consisted of the Roman Catholic, the Orthodox, and the Anglican. And we differed slightly, but we were Catholic, and we believed that. Yep. And for a number of years, we were very happy in that. However, in the meantime, we were not aware, because we were pretty sheltered in Texas, actually, what was going on in the leadership of the Episcopal Church and how they were rejecting more and more and more of apostolic faith. And we just weren't aware of it in Texas. But at that point, I wanted to study theology. I had wanted to for a long, long time. And so I decided to go back to graduate school. And it was fascinating because I applied to several good graduate schools in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. And for the first time in my life, I prayed, God's will be done, when I put those applications in the mail. I had never done that before. And I had, at the last minute, applied to the University of Dallas because someone told me I should. I had never heard of it. It's a fine Catholic university.
Right, right.
And I was accepted there and given a full scholarship. And that made my decision.
Yeah.
And I knew that God had done that, because that was the only scholarship I was offered. And so I went. And I was really proud of that scholarship and that I was, you know, in the PhD program. And I just thought, oh, I am so great. But I soon learned, and God made it clear in many ways, I don't want you to get a PhD. You're not going to need it. I want you to work with the common people. You're to be teaching people, not working with the scholars. And so I quit when I reached the master's level. But, of course, I was learning wonderful Catholic theology. I was attending daily Mass. I was growing so much deeper in my Catholic faith than I had before. One day I was in the library studying the early church, and this is fascinating. I came across the word catechumenate, and I literally heard, not an audible voice, but in my head, this is what I want you to do with your education. And I thought, well, I don't even know what it is. But I quickly learned, and that has been my passion for the last 35 years. I went to the RCIA seminars. I attended a meeting for several years. I met with the RCIA leadership in Fort Worth and just kept learning and learning and learning. And then at the same time, I was asked to start teaching adults who were coming into the Episcopal Church, prepare them for confirmation. Okay. And so I combined my RCIA knowledge with what I was doing.
So as an Anglo-Catholic taking Catholic theology, were you comfortable?
Very.
Staying Anglican at the time?
Well, I was, because I thought I was Catholic.
Yeah, okay.
I wasn't seeing a conflict there.
And they were confronting you on that, per se, as a student in their classes?
They were not, because, I don't know, the professors would say, you know, I know who you are, I know your heart.
Right.
You're, you know, a serious believer.
Yeah. And well, they're letting the truth speak for itself.
Yes.
Is what they were.
And one of the things I remember is sitting in class, and most of my professors at the time, I was so blessed, they were still the Cistercians who had escaped from Hungary.
Yes.
And they were still there. They were still alive.
I love that church down there.
And I can remember sitting in class, just tears streaming down my face because of hearing truth. It just was piercing my heart. But still, there was no conflict with Anglicanism. I was just growing deeper, I thought. No.
Our guest tonight is Cris Fouse, former Episcopalian, just for those you've tuned in. You know, I love that Cistercian church down there.
Yes.
That's a beautiful,
and the school.
Awesome. Oh, mm-hmm. It's wonderful
it
down
is.
There. So what a great environment
oh,
to
it
go.
Was.
Unexpectedly, mm-hmm. You didn't know you're dipping your toe as deeply into Catholic
I
waters.
I didn't. But
or
I
that
was,
you would need to make the move. So.
Mm-hmm. Another thing that happened during that time was I was blessed to make a trip to Israel. And of course, all the blessings that everybody receives if they're blessed to go there. But what stood out in my mind just all day, every day, was the high priestly prayer of Jesus in John 17 when he prayed for unity.
Yeah.
And it just kept, I don't know what it was, but it just kept piercing my heart and saying, we have to have unity or we cannot witness to the world. And I look back and I think, that was 1980, I look back and think that was probably the beginning of my real journey toward the Catholic Church, was longing for the unity that I didn't see in Christianity.
I was thinking that sometimes it's being either in the mission field or in that place where you really see how the disunity of Christianity has had such an effect,
mm-hmm.
by seeing that cacophony of what should be similar voices are sometimes at each other's throats,
yes.
for the sake of Christ.
And then began to think, okay, you know, if the Holy Spirit is working within the church, the Holy Spirit cannot be divided. He cannot be leading all these people in different directions with different theologies. Now, something is really wrong here. So I began to think in those terms. But I still was happy to be an Anglican. Then, along about that time, too, I began to be more aware of the leadership of the Episcopal Church,
yeah.
and really Western Anglicanism, and began to be distressed about it. I was sent to, I mean, I was deputy for my diocese to General Convention in 1985 for the Episcopal Church, which was held in Detroit. And I remember it was a two-week meeting, and I spent most of the first 10 days crying because I was so shocked and appalled at what I was seeing and hearing. And I don't want to go into the horror stories
right.
of it, but it was just seeing the worst of the worst.
Yeah. When you were there, I know we don't want to go on the worst of the worst, but when you were there, would you sense that the people who were way off in the into the crazies, that they sincerely thought they were following Christ?
I thought they did.
Okay.
Yes. I thought, you know, they believed they were following the Holy Spirit and that the Holy Spirit was leading them into new things. And
yeah.
Not realizing that the Holy Spirit doesn't speak against the Father and the Son, nor does he speak against, you know, tradition.
Yeah, right, right.
But it was a confusing time because I still was thinking like a Protestant in that, well, our parish is okay. You know, we're fine here in Texas. I don't have to worry about all that. So the conflict kind of went on. But back to RCIA, and my work in my parish began to, because at that time you may
so you, that's still what you called it as an Anglo. I just want to be essentially is that's what
well
you,
we did, but not publicly really.
Right. Right.
We just called it confirmation preparation.
Right. And maybe I was thinking since the word catechumenate had so caught you.
Mm-hmm.
It might be good to define to the audience what that word meant for you, catechumenate. What does that mean?
Okay, well, it was the method used in the early church to bring pagans into the church. And it was a three-year process, usually, yeah. because they were pagans. They had no knowledge of the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. They did not know the law of Moses. They did not know, of course, Jesus. But they were attracted to the Christians
yeah.
because of the way they treated one another and everyone else. You know, they ministered to everyone out there. They, hospitals, you know, serving the poor. It didn't matter who they were. They served them. And they loved one another so deeply. And so it attracted the pagans. What is it that you have? You know, I want some of that too. But because they were pagans, it took time. It was a process, a journey.
And it was a guarded process.
Yes, very
carefully. I remember Newman's book about the fourth century heresies. He describes that process in that book quite well. So that they aren't given the whole package.
Right.
It was slowly given to them over a long period of time as they understood, as the leadership could make sure that the deposit of faith could be handed off
Absolutely.
To them as they matured in their journey.
And meanwhile, their lives were being transformed, right. and they were changing, you know, deep within, and giving up their pagan jobs if they had to, and, yeah. you know, making all kinds of sacrifices to become part of that body, although they were not allowed, as you know, to attend any worship services because they weren't yet ready. And of course, being under persecution, if they were caught participating in the Eucharist, you know, everyone could be killed, the bishop, the priest, and everyone else who had anything to do with it. So they had to be very sure they were not sneaking off and telling the authorities what was going on.
Yeah, it was a difficult time, which we take flippantly now, 2,000 yeah. years later.
You know, although we shouldn't, because there are more persecutions now exactly. than there were then.
Exactly, right.
In other countries.
So you, in the part of your story, you're starting to recognize some of the flaws in the leadership of the Episcopal
yes,
Church.
Yes, and that they really were rejecting tenets of the faith and morality that had stood for 2,000 years or more, 5,000.
Yeah. No. Yeah. I was thinking recently, I read something where, you know, Jesus talks about the narrow gate. Mm-hmm. And what we have is denomination after denomination by a democratic vote widening that gate wider and wider to what it means to be an authentic Christian. And using modern philosophy or relativism or values clarification to redefine what sin is.
Things in the 70s, yes.
Yeah, pretty soon there's no gate at all. It's just a wide open door.
And what you said about democratic vote, that's exactly what the Episcopal Church was doing, as though theology could be changed by vote.
Yeah.
And, you know, that was happening. So I began to see, you know, something is wrong here. This really isn't the way it should be. But still, my parish was fine.
Okay.
Let's see. Back to the catechumenate and what I was doing in the parish. We ended up, because RCIA at the time depended mostly on speculation and feelings, rather than teaching the faith.
Macrame and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm. So my pastor and I decided that we would write a curriculum for use in our parish. And it was very, very effective. And soon we began to share it with other parishes because they knew that something significant was happening there. And so we published a book in 1984, a leader's manual and a workbook called Christian Formation, a 20th Century Catechumenate. And that was sold, you know, pretty widely around the country, and a number of parishes are still using that.
Okay.
So that was, you know, very exciting. And because of
From
that
an Anglo-Catholic perspective?
Yes, definitely. Right. And teaching the seven sacraments and everything.
It may have then had some influence on sparking people to move forward.
Well, I hope so. And I know in a few cases it did,
yeah,
and
okay.
including the man who sent in my name to be on this program.
Okay.
Anyway, I was at a big international conference on education, and I met an African bishop. And he had learned about Christian formation, so he had a good long talk and invited me to come to his diocese to teach his clergy and lay leaders about Christian formation, because I don't know how much you know about the church in Africa, and I can't speak for the Catholic Church because I was an Anglican at the time, but every pastor has from 4 or 5 to up to 20 parishes that he's responsible for. And of course they walk there or possibly ride a bike, and they can't be at every parish very frequently. And so the parishes are left in the care of lay catechists who are deeply, deeply committed to Christ. They know their Bibles backwards and forwards, even if they're illiterate and can't even read them, but they know them. They're very serious about teaching the faith. They prepare the children for First Communion, confirmation. They bring in converts, prepare for marriage. They do everything that a lay person can do. Of course, they can't do a mass, but they do morning prayer, which is a beautiful Anglican tradition.
Right.
And but their methods of teaching were all lecture. There wasn't any interaction or discussion. And we learned that they're kind of afraid of being questioned for fear they won't be able to answer, you know, that kind of thing. So the goal of the bishops was to enable the lay catechists to do better out there in the bush where they had their parishes. And so that was, we ended up going to 27 dioceses. It was well established in 27 dioceses, 9 countries. Christian formation was translated into 12 African languages that we know of. And still to this day, some of them contact me for, you know, advice.
You know, that's absolutely tremendous when you think about, of course, when you recognize through the baptism, the wider church, we pray for unity, but still at the same time, we celebrate with our brothers and sisters in Christ, of course. But I was thinking about the bishops seeing what's happened in Western Episcopalianism and how these fairly, these deeply committed lay catechists in Africa, they would be absolutely shocked.
Oh, they are shocked when they,
when they hear about
that.
So what's forming them to stay tight with Jesus Christ?
Yes.
A program like this is what making sure they've got something to hold on to in their faith. No.
Absolutely.
You know, our goal, of course, would be to, that would be fully Catholic, but in time.
Yes,
in time.
And I, you know, I still think because it is Catholic teaching that eventually that's going to lead, and it has a few that I know of.
Yeah, well, that's exciting. Let's pause there.
Okay.
Our guest tonight is Cris Fouse, and we'll just take a moment. I'd like you to pause as we do during this break to think about the influence that she's had as the Lord has used her through this program that you put together there for the Anglo-Catholic Church to help catechize those African lay leaders in all those dioceses. Praise God.
Praise God.
That is a great thing. That's wonderful. Be back in a moment. Welcome back to The Journey Home. Our guest tonight on this beginning of the 18th season is Cris Fouse. And in fact, I just mentioned just before we came on that 17 years ago, she's former Anglican, talking about her Anglo-Catholic. Well, the first guest on The Journey Home was Tom Howard. And the second guest was former Bishop Graham Leonard. And he would appreciate all that you're talking about because of some of the same issues that began bothering him.
Yes, I was very much aware of him. I was honored to meet him a few times. We were on the same page.
Yes. Okay, I paused you in the middle of your journey, and you're talking about how God opened the doors for not only utilizing your gifts to help produce us materials, but then using these gifts so widely in Africa. That's amazing to me.
Well, it was amazing to me. I had never in my life dreamed that I would ever leave my country and go anywhere. But God was, again, so patient. My children, all three children, were grown and married before this call to Africa came. And so I could go. And I actually went 34 times.
Wow.
Yeah, but I have never received such a great blessing as being there and being with those people. And, you know, I learned what a real Christian is just by being around them. I mean, the total dependence on God, the total trust in Him, not only daily but hourly. The humility, the gentleness, the generosity. They will give you anything they have, and they have nothing.
I think it was St. Francis. Maybe it was Bonaventure that we often, when we think about the Eucharist as the body of Christ, as the sacrament, and it is, of course, the authentic, true body and blood of Christ, that there's also a sense in which the poor are uniquely Jesus too, because we said, whatever you do to them, you do to me. Mm-hmm. And there's that uniqueness, that they have this unique encounter with Jesus when you're with the poor in Africa, particularly.
Yes, yeah. That was certainly true. And what an inspiration they are, you know, to especially learning to trust God absolutely with everything. And I didn't know whether I was going to mention this or not, but I think I will. during those years when I was traveling to Africa, two things happened in my family that were very, very difficult. Our first grandson was born with a lot of problems. He had a very, very difficult life. He lived a year and 4 days.
Wow.
And it was, it's hard. but somehow God sustained us through this, and we still were able to trust in Him. And that,
as opposed to turning.
Yes,
because that could be the temptation.
Yeah. And then the second thing was about 2 years later, our daughter was diagnosed with kidney cancer and had her kidney removed. 10 years later, it came back. She had her pancreas and various other things removed. She's going to be 51 next week. And she's doing beautifully, beautifully. But her example was, you know, God is in control. This is His life. And she was a beautiful example to all of us. And you know, we were able to walk through those times and not fall apart.
To Him. I probably should ask before, when you were making those 30-some visits to Africa, was it you and your husband going, or just yourself?
No, he didn't go.
Okay.
He held down the home fort, and he was working, and was not a possibility for him. But he was very, very supportive.
And, all right. And during all those times, were you still solidly Anglo-Catholic?
Yes.
So it didn't budge you. Did you encounter Catholic missionaries over there? Was there a sense, was there any leaning, any
There really wasn't time. I mean, I was working 24/7 when I was there. But there was an openness, and it was wonderful when I would start. Some of the Africans are very evangelical in Anglicanism. And when I would start talking about Catholic things, they would be so responsive, and you know, even like making the sign of the cross, well, wonder why we don't do that. And so we'd have a discussion about it. And, you know, the sacraments. I mean, it just, I had an opportunity to tell them things they'd never heard before. And yet in a way that they were very open to hearing and very appreciative of hearing.
So still amazes me when you think about going back to evangelize Africa, which is one of the earliest evangelized, converted parts of the world.
Mm-hmm.
But because of all the changes through the attack of Islam in the 7th century, you know, and it was lost in the faith.
Yes.
And now we're coming, but now we're coming back around, and the faith is growing stronger there than anywhere in the world.
Oh, very strong. And of course, now the Africans are evangelizing us,
which
I love.
Praise God.
Yes. And a number of them are here in Catholic parishes and Anglican parishes, and really bringing that commitment back. So in the meantime, I was aware of the Episcopal Church, you know, going down the slippery slope. And I began, I was reflecting back to that experience in Israel and the longing for unity. And I began to have this terrible conflict within me. I mean, I wanted the unity, I wanted the truth, I wanted the authority that the Catholic Church had and Anglicanism didn't. But I also wanted the beauty of holiness and the beautiful worship that Anglicans do, especially Anglo-Catholics, do have. The rich history, theologically rich hymns instead of shallow whatever. Sorry. Right. So that was there. And then I also, in talking about becoming Catholic, a number of these, especially the Africans, and a lot of the priests and bishops, Anglican priests and bishops here, would say, we need you here. We need you to keep teaching. And I was doing a lot of teaching. I was a member of Forward in Faith North America, which is connected. It was founded in England as a revival of the Oxford movement of John Henry Newman. Right. And so I was part of that and working internationally in England and Australia as well as here, and doing a lot of teaching and a lot of seminars, a lot of workshops. And so they would say, you know, we need you. Our people need to be taught. Don't go. And, you know, my pride got in the way there. It was nice to hear that from important people. But I also really believed that God had called us into the Episcopal Church and that I needed to stay there, even though it was difficult, and do whatever he asked me to do. And so the conflict just grew, and, you know, for 20 years it really did. Wow. I still really kept believing we were Catholic, but then I began to look at the Nicene Creed, which we said every Sunday, and I realized we were not one. The Archic talks had sort of fallen apart. Anglicanism itself was radically divided. We were not holy because the morality, you know, the things that they were voting on were just eroding morality. Catholic, we were not, you know, the Vincentian canon was not being upheld in Catholic in the Anglican Church. And of course, apostolic succession, we'd always believed that we had it because we could trace the laying on of hands all the way back. But it had been broken at the Reformation. And then when the Anglican Church started ordaining women, you know, that broke it even more.
And plus, so, apostolic succession isn't merely
The laying on of hands. It's the faith. We were not maintaining the faith, and I realized that. Yeah. And so I looked at that. I said, we say this every week, but we're not living up to this. So the conflict went on. And then finally, in 2008, God said, it's time. And it was a, you know, dramatic message. We were at worship in our Anglican parish, and I suddenly knew I cannot go up for communion. I cannot do it. And so I whispered to my husband, I'm going to leave after the peace, and I'll meet you in the car. He said, I'll come with you.
Was he on the same journey?
Well, he was. Yeah. He was. And so I decided, oh my goodness, I don't even know where the nearest Catholic church is. I better find one. And what I discovered was a fairly small parish called St. Mark Denton was the closest to us. And so I said, well, I'm going to go visit. I'll go on Saturday evening so I can still go with you on Sunday. And so I did. And the first moment I walked in there, I thought, oh my goodness, this is enormous. And there are thousands of strangers in here. I was used to a very small parish as an Anglican. Totally overwhelming, but keep going, you're here. And of course, the liturgy was totally familiar. That parish was very reverent. They even knelt on the bare floor because we didn't have kneelers at the time, but they were kneeling. I was, oh, this is good. The scripture was Matthew 16, when Jesus chose Peter.
Right.
And I had struggled with that passage 1,000 times, but this time when I heard it read, it pierced my heart. It just was, this is true. Peter is the head of the church forever. Second thing that happened at the peace, I turned around and directly behind me was a woman who had been in my Anglican parish, who had returned to the Catholic Church. I said, I know one person in this crowd of strangers. This is good. Third thing that happened was after Mass, I found a table where they were signing up for Catholic Bible study. And I thought, oh my goodness, Catholics have Bible study. This is really good.
Surprise.
Yes, I was. I'm sorry to say. And then the final thing was, on the way home, there was a complete brilliant double rainbow from one side of the street to the other. And it stayed with me almost all the way home. And so I had to say, okay, God, it's time. It really is. And within 2 weeks, my husband visited with me. Within a month, we had both gone to talk to the priest and had decided this is what we are ready to do. And so we came into the church together in November 08. And that was amazing. No, just amazing. So it was wrenching in, you know, in a lot of ways, because we had been so deeply involved in our parish and loved all the people. I had to give up all my ministries that I loved
so
much.
Yeah, yeah. That whole thing that you had been so involved with worldwide, that you'd have to...
I did. But we were ready.
But
we just were ready.
But that is the calling anyway of the following of Christ, is there are times we have to just move forward and trust that...
Leave things in the past and let Him move us forward.
One of the problems that Anglo-Catholics sometimes encounter when they do come into the church, as you said, one holy Catholic and apostolic, and when you enter through the doors, you end up finding that the Catholic Church herself is quite diverse now.
Oh, yes, and enormous compared to...
How do you feel about that as you encountered that, you and your husband?
Well, just a lot of joy that it's so much bigger and deeper and richer and complicated and universal, and it's just, there's so much there. You just never get to the end of learning and appreciating the history, the universality, just the knowledge that this is God's church, and it always has been.
And even if well-meaning Catholics, though maybe not as well catechized as they ought to be, think that there should be more democratic theology in the church to change things, that doesn't happen every summer at some general assembly.
Right, right.
That ain't going to happen because of the church's commitment under the Holy Spirit to guard the deposit.
Exactly. And when we made that vow, you know, at our confirmation, that was just powerful. That's what it's all about. We are. One thing I forgot to mention was that coming into the church, I realized that I had actually been worshiping the worship in the Anglican Church instead of obeying God for years. I felt so bad. Yeah. But I realized it. I finally realized it. My eyes were open. Go ahead.
I was going to say that can be a problem for almost anyone, because we become attached to that which we're most comfortable.
Mm-hmm.
You know, whether you're congregationalist and that's what you really like
all
your life,
the
music of a certain tradition, and then that brings a tear to your eye when you hear a song from 50 years ago. That's a good thing to build on, but we have to make sure it's true.
Exactly, right? And that was the second thing. I was really holding beauty over truth. And the beauty of worship that Anglicanism has, I loved. I still love it. But I have something better now.
We have an email. Connie from New Hampshire addresses the very question. Does Cris miss any elements of the liturgy she experienced as an Episcopalian?
I do, and yet I'm willing to give it up. I mean, it's worth it. Because what the Catholic Church gives me is so much richer.
Right. And trustworthy.
You
know, that we will, I mean, the church has the authority to change aspects in its worship, but not willy-nilly, you know.
Exactly.
Or, you know, based on which group has the most to get a 5-4 vote at the, you know, no, it's guided by the Holy Spirit.
But in recent years, the last 2 or 3 years, it is turning around again.
Yeah.
You know, with the change in the liturgy, it's more steeped in what it was in the Latin, and reverence is coming back.
Yeah.
I'm noticing that. That, and I really appreciate that. And I realize too in the church that it takes time. You know, the pendulum swings and you can't just correct all that overnight. But it's happening.
And because the church is so big, there are places where it was never lost.
Right, right.
Or in some places, but it seemed like it was totally gone, but then it kind of ebbs and flows at different places. I got an email from Devin from the Midwest. My family and I are lifelong Anglicans who have become uncomfortable with the direction of the Anglican Church. We are looking into Catholicism but are concerned that the issues that plague the Anglican communion, particularly the moral issues, might also become present in the Catholic Church. What are your thoughts?
Well, they're trying, but it's not going to happen because the church is so strong and it will uphold the faith. It will uphold the tradition.
Which is one of the reasons that Pope Francis is moving this fall to recognize the sanctity of Paul the Sixth.
Yes.
Because he stood, one of the reasons is he stood tight with all the pressures to assume that the push would go essentially in the direction that the Episcopalians have gone.
That's
and he
right.
said no.
And the push is there.
Yeah.
But they will not yield. And it's interesting how often what Pope Francis says is so misinterpreted. You know, he's going down the liberal path. No, he's not.
No,
listen to what he really says.
He's reminding us of a part that sometimes we forget, and that, of course, is the poor. And our ecumenical love for brothers and sisters that doesn't mean indifferentism,
exactly.
but it means being loving to all.
Love them first and bring them to the truth.
Yeah, and
absolutely.
Through that love. Email from Janice from Washington, D.C. Why do you think that Episcopalians would be drawn towards the Catholic Church? The Episcopal Church is so similar to Catholicism with its liturgy and sacraments. I don't understand why Episcopalians would want to leave their familiar surroundings and become Catholic. I know firsthand that often Catholics aren't very welcoming, and their parishes don't always offer many ways to get involved in ministries and such.
Oh my. Well, yes, I understand what she's saying because I've been there, but again, when you see what the church does have and what it does offer. Now, I haven't found that it's hard to get involved. And you know, the two parishes I've been in, because we recently moved to Austin just a year ago, they've had so many activities and so many possibilities for people to be part of small groups and get to know. I found it could be overwhelming because of the size of the parishes. So it's essential to get involved in something smaller, but it's there.
But the Lord, at the time you were doing the catechesis, that was the time that God was using for you for that purpose, in His name.
Mm-hmm.
But there were also gifts that you brought back with you in those ways, the catechesis and things. And I think for a lot of people that come into the church, they have gifts that God's calling them to share when they come home.
Yes. And it might not be immediately, but he will guide us into where we belong in the Catholic Church, because there is a place for us there.
This program is airing on the feast of the Nativity of Our Lady. Where was Our Lady in your whole spiritual journey?
Well, not really very much there. I began to know her as an Anglican, as a High Church Anglican. We had a beautiful statue of Our Lady of Walsingham in our parish. And I learned to say the rosary, which I love. I am still growing in that, in my relationship with her. I don't feel a real closeness yet. But I'm beginning to look at her as my mother.
I was going to say, you might relate to many converts that you know, it's kind of like the words of that father that said, "I believe, now help my unbelief." It's a journey.
It is.
And especially when you've come from a background where she was not included. I remember Father Graham Leonard talking about, you know, once you pull Mary out of the equation of salvation history, you literally drop Jesus from his place. But it takes a while to move Mary back into the equation.
It is. And understanding that, you know, the queen was always the mother of the king. And that Old Testament, I'm learning a lot from that history that so much applies to her that I never realized before. But right. She is so important. And I also believe that losing her has caused a lot of the problem with feminism in the church. That we didn't have a wonderful feminine example. And so we've created it in other ways, which is, you know, wrong.
What about your children? Did they follow you into the church?
Oh, that's... our one son became Catholic 10 years before we did.
Interesting, okay.
With his family, yes. The other two have not. But, you know, a mother keeps praying.
But that first son that came in 10 years, did he have a big influence then on your own journey?
Yes and no. Because I understood completely what he was doing and why he was doing it, and I totally affirmed it. I went up and kept the children when they went to the RCIA retreat, and I was completely delighted for them. But I just wasn't ready yet. And yet I knew that someday I would be.
Right. Yeah. Well, and that I really do that believe that's important. You know, sometimes when we look at people who seem to know all about the church but don't come in, we want to say, well, it's their stubbornness. Mm-hmm. But then when we do come in, we say, well, no, it was the grace of God that opened my heart. Well, maybe it's somewhere in between. We need to recognize that we want God's grace to be guiding them.
Absolutely.
And so the timing, we want it to be right for that person. It's got to be right, because God might have them right where he wants them to be, as he had you many years doing a great work for him in that place, until it's time for them to come home. Our desire is for all to come home.
It is.
But in God's...
And sometimes I look at myself and think, was I hard-hearted and stubborn? Or was I...
Well, we all are. Probably.
Yes, to a certain degree, we all are.
Until we enter into heaven by God's grace.
And yet he was patient. You know, he was gentle. He allowed me to work at my pace, and was there all the time, and said, until he said, this is it. Don't waste any more time.
We have an email, Elsie from Long Island. How can... and the ordinary Catholic witness for Jesus in their everyday life? I can't go on mission trips or even volunteer extensively for my parish because of family commitments, but I'd still like to somehow bring people closer to Christ and
His
church.
Oh, that's a beautiful question. That's a beautiful question. And I guess my only answer would be yourself and love God and just let Him work in you. Because wherever we are, wherever He puts us,
yeah,
is where he wants us to work for him and do his will. And if you never get out of your house, if you have, you know, six little children, then being their mother at this time in their life is what you're to do. And
well, that prayer that you prayed, you said you had prayed for the first time when you were applying for graduate schools, is such an important prayer.
Mm-hmm.
Lord, mm-hmm, whatever you want. What do you want me to do, Lord?
Yeah. And in this place, how can I serve you where I am?
Yeah, yeah. And of course, usually that begins at home.
Mm-hmm.
And then the...
And then he may move you into someplace else.
Concentric circles beyond that.
Or right. He may not. You know, he may want you in this particular place for your lifetime, but he has a purpose for that. And that's one of the exciting things is to know that every one of us is created for a purpose. And you look at Jeremiah, you know, before I knew you. And before I knew you in the womb, I'm not getting that straight because I'm nervous, that each one of us has a purpose. And if we just will be open to what that is, then he can work within us. And then when we go wrong, when we don't listen carefully and we go down the wrong path, he'll bring us back. No, he always does. And to say that, okay, what if I don't hear him right? Well, take a step. So there's that wonderful saying about, you know, if you're sailing, you have to put the sail up and go, and then God can guide you. If you're just sitting there in the harbor without the sail up, you're not going to go anywhere.
Yeah. But you take a step. The whole boat might be going sideways with the current, you know, as opposed to letting the Spirit lead, the wind.
Let Him lead, and if you make a wrong turn, He'll lead you back.
Which requires our freedom of the will to say often, Lord, you know, I love you. I want to follow you.
Yes.
Forgive me.
Yes.
Guide me. I mean, that's really all. Yes, guide me.
And that forgiveness is so beautiful, because we all do make mistakes and deliberately go wrong, but he forgives.
Cris, thank you very,
thank
very
you, Marcus.
Much
for this sharing
with
delightful.
Us on the journey home. Thank you. And thank you for being open to how all the ways the Lord has used you and continues to use you as a servant and as
so.
A child. Thank you very
so.
Much.
Thank you.
And thank you for joining on this start of the 18th season of the Journey Home. I pray that Cris's journey is an encouragement to you. God bless. See you next week.